Hi! I think my FlickerFlame bulb is faulty, even though these are deliberately designed in the wrong way to cause the flicker. Mine is not flickering in their typical pattern. It may unintentionally be built wrongly, in the wrong way. Why does this one have a steady discharge at the upper tip and only flicker down towards the bottom part? And why is the electrical discharge not just taking the shortcut between the two closely spaced electrodes? Let's examine how this one works using spectroscopy, slow motion, and a weird, unintuitive physical phenomenon. No major issues in the following experiments. Just have respect for the high voltage of mains electricity. This is my only flicker flame bulb. It is misbehaving compared to other similar versions I have seen. Usually these flicker between large patches on the bottom and top, but mine has a steady glow at the top and only some small frantic flickers at the bottom. It does look great, though the flame effect is not that convincing with the steady tip. The color of the discharge is beautiful. A saturated orange, not far from the color of the lovely low-pressure sodium vapor lamp I tested in my previous video. I wonder what gases are emitting this lamp's color. Luckily, I have a spectrometer that can tell us by showing the spectral lines of the light, the fingerprints of the gases inside, so to speak. To get as steady a reading as possible, I'll point the probe at the solid part of the glow, on the tip. That's not steady at all. We will see why later in some recordings at 1000 frames per second. Let me tweak the settings to get a more stable and stronger reading. That's much better. No nasty surprises here. Orange and red wavelengths dominate in the range our eyes can see. The strongest peak is a deep red on the border to near infrared, but our eyes are way more sensitive to the orange light emitted. A small surprise is the tiny amount of UVA making it through the glass of the lamp. Not enough to worry me or give me a tan though. Interestingly, all the noticeable spectral lines in ultraviolet, visible and infrared can be linked to one single elemental gas, neon. This is the purest neon spectrum I have measured so far. I have seen sources saying that these lamps contain a little argon too, like the pinning mixture inside a sodium lamp. I just don't see any signs of argon. Nice! Now we know the light is orange due to neon. But why is it flickering? Well, when electrodes are only partly glowing, it can indicate there's not enough electricity to make the whole thing light up. Let's see how many watts of electricity this lamp is using. Keep an eye on the amperage as I plug the lamp into the power meter. Okay, the current is less than 0.01 amps, so the wattage is less than 2.2 watts at 222 volts. The power meter should be able to measure down to 0.1 watt, but this bulb goes undetected. Odd. Officially, it is 3 watts at 240 volts. Making it around 2.5 watts at 222 volts, if the resistance is a fixed value over this voltage range. I guess it isn't, or this bulb is somehow faulty, since it is only sipping electricity. These lamps actually have a resistor in series, hidden in their socket, making sure the current is kept really low. Too much current would turn the discharge into an arc, a spark. Okay, the low current explains why it isn't all of the electrode surface that is lit up. There are simply not enough electrons going through the lamp for it. But why are the electrons, the electrical discharge, not just taking the shortest path and staying there? Why are they flickering around on the surfaces facing away from each other? Seems easier to just jump the only 1 mm gap between the electrodes. Not logical, not intuitive to me. To see the discharge movement in more detail, I would like to record it in slow motion. Time to record in 1000 frames per second. I was surprised by what I saw on the camera's screen. Look at that. The tip is not always lit. The discharge is always on the move and switching side. Explains the unstable reading during the spectrometry. The electrodes take turns on having the discharge due to the AC cycle of the mains electricity. It is only the cathode that has a glow from the electrons leaving it and hitting the neon gas atoms. When the polarity changes, as the AC cycle crosses 0 volts, the other electrode turns into the cathode with a discharge glow. This pattern reminds me of a Jacob's ladder, where the heated, ionized air rises and the arc follows it. I therefore also tried placing the lamp vertically, as intended, and record in slow motion again. Will the discharge now move upwards for each cycle, like in a Jacob's ladder? Nope, still going from tip to bottom, the opposite way of a Jacob's ladder. What is going on? The explanation apparently can be found in this equation. I will attempt to explain it as best as I can, as the amateur I am, after thanking some awesome people. Thanks to my awesome patrons for helping out with the expensive but well worth it spectrometer. I wouldn't have it without your support. For just a dollar a month, you can help me out too and get full access to all my posts on patreon.com. Link to my Patreon page in the description. Thank you. This equation is Paschen's law. This can be used to calculate the voltage needed for a gas to break down into a discharge between two electrodes. Relevant for our neon flame effect bulb. It shows that the voltage for the discharge is dependent on the pressure of the gas and the distance between the electrodes, but not in a linear way. If this formula is drawn as graphs, it turns out the optimal condition for the discharge is not at the lowest pressure or at the shortest distance. There is a sweet spot where the discharge can jump at the lowest possible voltage, where the gas is not too thin and the distance not too short. If I understand this correctly, the neon gas inside the bulb is at such a low pressure that the short 1 mm gap between the electrodes is too short for the discharge. There are simply too few neon atoms in the thin, low pressure gas in a 1 mm short gap. Too few to make it likely for electrons to hit enough neon atoms in the chain reaction needed to form an ionized, low resistance path for the discharge. Under the conditions inside the lamp, an ionized path can only be formed by free electrons on a longer path from electrode to electrode. In my bulb, the discharge always starts at the tip, where the possible ionization paths are the shortest, but not too short, between the surfaces facing away from each other. This is a design fault. In the better bulbs, the electrode tips are bent away from each other to increase their distance, making the breakdown more likely to start at the bottom and move upwards. The reason for the motion is found in the other factor in Paschen's law, pressure. Once the discharge strikes, the glowing part of the neon is fiercely heated up. Heated gas expands, lowering the local density and pressure inside the glowing part of the neon until it is too low for the discharge, forcing the discharge to move on into the colder, denser, locally higher pressure gas next to it. On the tip, the surface is narrow, so the discharge can fill and follow the same path every time. That's why its glow appears solid to our eyes. It is lighted up in every cycle, 50 times a second. But once the discharge reaches the wider part, the low current limits how wide the discharge can be. It can't fill the whole width of the electrode, so the path followed becomes random, based on irregularities in the surface coating, turbulence in the gas, and probably even the random ionizing effect of the background radiation. I find this faulty lamp fascinating. Such a delicate balance between voltage, current, distance, pressure and temperature. A marvelous demonstration of Paschen's law. Click like if you feel it too, and comment if you want to see other experiments with this lamp. For example, how it reacts to extreme magnets, strong radioactive sources, temperature changes, voltage changes, or the electric field of a plasma ball, or even a Tesla coil. Remember to subscribe for free or miss out. In any case, thanks for watching. Bye for now.